Hello.
Salut, Laurent.
Welcome to Hamilton College. For those of you who are visiting us from afar off or near off places, I already, on my way here, met a couple of folks who drove all the way from Rochester. Where are my Rochester folks? All right, props to you. My name is Amit Taneja. I'm the Director of Diversity and Inclusion at Hamilton College. Thank you. You can keep going. It's my pleasure to introduce our keynote speaker, Laverne Cox, today, who's excited. So I want to give you a little bit of context of what else is happening, because some of our visitors might see some folks walking around with these badges. Hamilton College is in an awesome consortium with five other private liberal arts colleges in the upstate New York area. And those are Hobart William Smith, Union College, St. Lawrence University, Skidmore College, and Colgate University. Wonderful. So this is the first time that we're actually doing a really historic conference, that the six schools have gotten together, and we are hosting a conference called Spectrum for LGBTQ, IASS, all the alphabet letters, for folks to come together and talk about issues that are common on our campuses. So I'm very thankful for the volunteers and the ushers and the conference team who helped me plan this conference. If you help with the conference or you're ushering, please wave or stand and be acknowledged. Thank you. I also want to thank Jenny Turvey in my office, who made a lot of these arrangements and made it possible. Thank you, Jenny. Can you wave to the folks? All right, so let me give you a little bit about how this is going to go. We are on a very tight schedule because this lecture is part of the keynote for the conference. So we will have food and other things we need to get to. In a few moments, I'm going to invite Laverne Cox to come out, and she's going to talk for about 40 minutes or so. And then we're going to have about 15 or 20 minutes for Q&A. There will be three volunteers with mics, which I have not assigned yet, but I will in a minute. Right here, three volunteers with mics, okay? Mics upstairs. Excellent. This is how we get work done. And so you'll have a chance to ask some questions. There is, unfortunately, because we're on a strict schedule, we don't have opportunities for folks to come up and do a meet and greet and take a picture or do a selfie, because we have to leave immediately after the lecture is done. Conference attendees, for those who are with the badges, you're going to walk up the stairs and you're going to go out those doors. Right up there. Everybody else can exit through those doors. Please no flash photography or video recording. If you want to tweet, Facebook, hashtag, Snapface, whatever it is, like, feel free to do that. And this might be also be a good time to turn off your cell phones. All right, so without further ado, I'm very pleased to introduce Laverne Cox, our keynote speaker for the Spectrum Conference. Laverne Cox is an actress, writer, producer, and transgender advocate. She can currently be seen in the critically acclaimed Netflix original series, Orange is the New Black. Her portrayal of the incarcerated Sophia Brissett has touched the heart of viewers all over the place. She's the first African-American trans woman to produce and star in her own television show, VH1's critically acclaimed Transform Me. The show was nominated for a GLAAD Media Award for Outstanding Reality Program in 2011 and was the first television show to star three transsexual women. Cox also made television history when she became the first African-American trans woman to appear on a reality television program, VH1's I Wanna Work for Diddy, in 2008. She accepted the GLAAD Media Award for Outstanding Reality Program for I Want to Work for Diddy in 2009. She was recently the recipient of the Anti-Violence Project's 2013 Courage Award. As a transgender advocate, Cox continues to lend her voice to the cause of transgender visibility and equality. She's committed to telling diverse and three-dimensional trans stories in the media. Please join me in giving a very warm upstate welcome to Laverne Cox.
Hamilton College, thank you so much. Spectrum Conference, thank you so much. The New York Six, I just heard about the New York Six. I love the idea of the New York Six. It makes me very excited. I am so honored to be here, and I have to tell you, I almost didn't make it. I had several flight delays, and I was supposed to come in through Syracuse, and I ended up coming in through Rochester, but we made it. We made it tonight. You guys look so good today. So happy to be here. I stand before you this evening, a proud African-American transgender woman. From a working class background, raised by a single mother, I stand before you an artist and an actress, a daughter and a sister. And I believe it's important to name the intersecting components of my multiple identities, because I'm not just one thing, and neither are you. I believe it's important to claim the various intersecting components of my multiple identities with pride, because I have not always been able to do so. I've often carried shame about various aspects of who I am. And let's face it, being a working class, black, transgender woman is not necessarily a celebrated class in this society. It's quite the contrary. Our unemployment rate is twice the national average. For trans people of color, it's four times the national average. The homicide rate in the LGBTQ community is highest amongst trans women. In 2012, it was over 53% of all LGBTQ homicides were trans women. 73% were people of color. 16% of the transgender population has experienced incarceration, compared to 10% of the rest of the population. 78% of students in grades K through 12 who express a transgender or gender non-conforming identity experience harassment. 78%. It is a state of emergency for far too many trans people all across this country. Dr. Cornel West reminds us that justice is what love looks like in public, and trans people need a lot of justice. We need a lot of love today. Black people need a lot of justice. We need a lot of love today. People with disabilities, poor people, need a lot of justice. We need a lot of love today. And ain't I a woman? It is my belief that one of the biggest obstacles facing the trans community are points of view which disavow our identities, points of view which suggest that no matter what we do, we are always and only the gender we were assigned at birth, points of view that suggest that no matter what I do, I'll never be a woman. Yet, ain't I a woman? Ain't I a woman? Sojourner Truth. Do you know Sojourner Truth? Yeah. Sojourner Truth spoke those powerful words in an iconic speech, Ain't I a Woman, on May 29th, 1851. It happens to be my birthday. Different year, though. I'm not quite that old. Although, that would be a fierce moisturizer, though, wouldn't it? Sojourner Truth spoke those powerful words, Ain't I a Woman, at the Ohio Women's Convention in 1851. She spoke those words within the context of a women's liberation struggle that suggested that she wasn't really a woman because she was black. She spoke those words within a social context that denied her very humanity because she was black. There's a famous story about Sojourner Truth, and in 1858, she was giving a speech, and someone yelled from the audience, calling her a man. And Sojourner Truth famously opened her blouse and revealed her breast. Now I'm not going to reveal my breast this evening. Sorry to disappoint some of you. But I do stand here tonight claiming my womanhood in a social context which often denies it. Now my feminist idol, a woman by the name of Bell Hooks. Do we know Bell Hooks? Mama Hooks. She took the title of the famous Sojourner Truth speech for her first book. She titled it "Ain't I a Woman? Black Women and Feminism," and she was critical of the historic devaluation of black womanhood in America. She was also critical of various aspects of women's liberation struggle that she found to be racist, to silence the voices of women of color. And she was also critical of elements of black liberation struggle that she found to be sexist, to silence the voices of black women. She was talking about issues of race, class, and gender, intersectional issues over 30 years ago before it was popular in certain circles to do so. I discovered Bell Hooks' work when I was a gender nonconforming college student in New York City, not unlike some of you, many of you here this evening. And when I discovered Bell Hooks' work, it was like oxygen to me. I came to critical consciousness reading her work. And there was another writer whose work really spoke to me at the time. It was a woman by the name of Judith Butler. Do we know Judith Butler? Good old Judy B. And specifically a moment in her iconic book, Gender Trouble. And there's a moment in Gender Trouble where Judith Butler is doing a critical analysis of Simone de Beauvoir's seminal text, The Second Sex. And many of you probably heard this, but Simone de Beauvoir writes in The Second Sex that one is not born a woman, but rather becomes one. Now the first time I heard this, I was very excited by that idea. One is not born a woman, but rather becomes one. I wasn't quite ready to fully accept, to own my own womanhood, but this idea of becoming, this idea of existence preceding essence, spoke volumes to me. And Judith Butler, in her analysis of this moment, said that nowhere in de Beauvoir's account is it guaranteed that the one who becomes a woman is necessarily female. Now I was very excited when I read this. So one is not born a woman, but rather becomes one. But the one who becomes a woman is not necessarily female. And ain't I a woman? Years before I was a gender nonconforming college student in New York City, I began becoming in Mobile, Alabama. Is there any South in the house? Anybody? Okay. I got you. I was born, as I said, to a single mother, and I was born exactly 7 minutes before my identical twin brother. So I'm older, and I never let him forget it. And my mother often worked two, sometimes three jobs to take care of my brother and me, but she eventually became a teacher. And education was very important in our household. My mother wanted to make sure that my brother and I understood the rich history of racial oppression that existed in the state in which we were born. But she was also keen to make us aware of the rich history of resistance to that oppression. Alabama is the state where George Wallace, the governor, in the early 1960s, famously stood in the door of the University of Alabama to keep that school from being desegregated. But Alabama is also the state where Rosa Parks famously refused to give up her seat on a Montgomery bus in 1955 and to a white man. And that defiant act became a seminal moment in our nation's civil rights struggle and kickstarted the Montgomery bus boycott. Those things both happened in Alabama. Stuff went down in Alabama. A lot of stuff went down. And before I knew anything about myself, I knew that I was black. The next several things I found out about myself, I found out when I began to interact with other students in preschool. I was greeted with words like sissy, words like the F word, which is a synonym for sissy. There's other kids said that I acted like a girl, whatever that means, since girls act all sorts of ways. And from preschool up until high school, I was basically bullied every day. I was called names. I was chased home from school practically every day. There was always one or several students who wanted to beat me up. And when I think about the bullying that I experienced as a child, that several things come to mind. First of all, I wonder how kids at 3, 4, 5 years old knew these words. I didn't even know what these words meant, and I was being called them. Where does a 3, 4, 5 year old learn sissy and the F word? Where do they learn those words? That's just one thing, one question that I have about the bullying that I experienced. And another observation is that often anti-gay slurs were used to bully me, but I was really being bullied because of my gender expression. The way that I acted wasn't consistent with how someone assigned male at birth was supposed to act. I was a very feminine child. And so often when kids are bullied across this country, it is about gender. It is about their gender expression, and we call it gay. And I think it's important if we want to end the bullying of kids in this country, we need to begin to create spaces of gender self-determination for kids. I think it's really important. Yes. because so often the logic of the flawed logic of the gender binary model basically states that if one is born with a penis, they will be masculine and attracted to women, and if one is born with a vagina, they will be feminine and attracted to men. The reality, though, of so many of our lives doesn't fit neatly into that binary model. So it's about creating spaces. You know, Facebook just, added all these gender classifications, and it's been, the source of some controversy and sort of satirical, conversations. But the reality is that many of us have a little bit of masculinity, have a little bit of femininity, and express our gender in multiple ways. And it's so important that we create spaces where we can, in each of us, can identify. So it's really great that Facebook did that, I think. And another thing that I think about when I think about the bullying I experienced as a kid is when my mother would find out about it, she would often ask me what I was doing to make the other kids treat me the way that they were. And why didn't I fight back? So I felt that it was my fault. I believed that it was my fault that the kids were treating me this way. And it really was the beginning of intense shame that I experienced. When I talk about shame, when I think about shame, I link it to internalized transphobia for me, internalized racism, internalized classism. But Brené Brown defines shame as the intensely painful belief of feeling unlovable, unworthy of love and belonging. And I certainly felt that as a child because of my gender expression, that I was unworthy of love and belonging. And shame has been a continuing theme throughout my life. I have to work to this day to have shame resilience in the face of all these things. So I didn't feel safe at school, and I didn't feel safe at home, but where I did feel safe as a child was in my imagination. I loved to dance as a kid, and I was pretty good at it, if I must say so myself. I was really good at looking at choreography on television and imitating it perfectly. And from the age of about 5 years old till third grade, I begged my mother to put me into dance classes because I wanted to be a professional dancer. And I always sort of I danced around everywhere, and I always sort of had music in my head, and I would express these characters through the dance. And finally, when I was in third grade, my mother found a program called Culture in Black and White in Mobile, and it was a low-income arts program. It was an arts program, for low-income students in my hometown. And I was just so happy to be finally taking dance classes. But the compromise was that I could take tap and jazz, but not ballet, because ballet was too gay in my mother's, according to my mother. But I was so happy. I didn't care. And yes. And there was... There was another incident that happened when I was in third grade that was a seminal moment in my childhood. My third grade teacher, Miss Ridgway, called my mother one day and said, "Your son is going to end up in New Orleans wearing a dress if we don't get him into therapy right away." Yes, that happened. The interesting thing is I was in New Orleans this past Monday at Tulane University, and it took over 20 years, but Ms. Ridgway's prediction finally came true. Talk about a full circle moment. But some of you have probably heard that story before, but what you might not know is the inciting incident which led to the call to my mother. We had gone to Six Flags on a church trip a few weeks earlier, and at the gift shop, I had a little bit of spending money, so I was in the gift shop at Six Flags, and I remember seeing this handheld fan, and I really wanted to have it. Yes, I did. Now, I'd seen Gone with the Wind several weeks before that. Yes, I had, and I wanted to be Scarlett O'Hara. And when I saw this fan, I saw my opportunity. And so I bought the fan, and so I'm sitting in class in third grade, just fanning myself, just standing away, feeling very Scarlett O'Hara, feeling very Gone with the Wind fabulous. And my teacher, Ms. Ridgway, says, "Come here and bring that thing with you." And then she marches me down the hall to the fifth grade teacher's class, Miss Fairley, and she says, "Show her what you were doing with that." And I'm like, "Yeah." And I start fanning myself, fanning away. And she's like, "Okay, stop, go back to class." And my mother got the call. And so I'm sitting in the therapist's office, and I remember that the therapist asked me if I knew the difference between a boy and a girl. And in my infinite wisdom as a third grader, because third graders are so wise, I said, "There is no difference." And this is years before Judith Butler and bell hooks, but the way the way I rationalized it in my head is that everyone was telling me that I was a boy, but I knew that I was a girl. I felt like I was a girl inside. So I rationalized that there must not be any difference. And when I think back on that moment, I often think about so many of transgender children now who we've seen on television and we've seen on TV talk shows, etc., who are transitioning at 3, 4, 5, 6 years old. And I think about what if the conversation had been like, let's explore that instead of the shaming that happened. Now when I was a kid, I watched tons of television, so I had assumed that I had doctor-patient privilege, so anything I said to the therapist was between me and the therapist. But apparently when you're in third grade, you don't have doctor-patient privilege. Who knew? So my mother found out every single thing I had said to the therapist, and instead of it being this exploratory moment to validate how I was feeling about myself and not shame me, it became this moment to reinforce the gender binary. "You're a boy, and boys are this, and girls are this," and she yelled at me profusely, and my mom was working really hard, taking care of two kids by herself, and she didn't have time for this. This was like this embarrassment. It was this thing that, what are people saying about her? So often, a lot of the shaming I experienced as a kid was about what other people might think, which really didn't help me. So I mentioned that we had gone to Six Flags on a church trip, and the church was a really important institution for me growing up. Going to church every Sunday was mandatory, and we were members of Bethel African Methodist Episcopal Church, the AME Church. Does anyone know the AME Church here? Hey! For those of you who don't know, the AME Church is actually the oldest all-black denomination in the country, and it was co-founded by a guy named Richard Allen in about 1794. Allen and his colleagues were frustrated with how black parishioners were being treated in the Methodist Church, and they decided to start their own their own church. And so we were members of Bethel in Mobile, Alabama. For those, if you ever go to Philadelphia, Mother Bethel still stands, and it's on the tour of Philly. We went there recently with my mom, and we took a tour. So you can check out Mother Bethel if you ever care to. And church was this wonderful place for me because I loved performing as a kid. So church for me was another performance opportunity. I was an usher and sang in the choir, and I was always one of those kids getting up and making speeches. So not much has changed. But church was also another place where I was told that who I was a problem. In sixth grade, I started going through puberty, and I remember that I really didn't want to have that happen. I remember not wanting to grow up and become a man, is what I remember. And as I was going through puberty, I started having these intense feelings and attraction towards other boys. Everyone was telling me I was a boy, and I was like, okay, whatever. And I was having attraction to other boys, and I learned in church that this was a sin. And when I was in sixth grade, my grandmother died. My grandmother was a remarkable woman. Her name was Emma Cox. But we called her Madea, sort of like that Tyler Perry character, but not really. Madea is short for Mother Dear, and it's a term of endearment for black mothers and grandmothers in the South. And when Madea died, it was an awful moment in our family. She was a maid, and she barely read and she could barely read and write, but she took care of 10 kids by herself. Practically, and she was just a remarkable woman. And I remember when she passed away, I was up late one night grieving her loss. And I remember having the intense feeling that she was up in heaven looking down on me, knowing what I was thinking and what the feelings I was having for other boys. And I felt like she was profoundly disappointed in the feelings and thoughts that I was having. And I went to the medicine cabinet in our apartment, and I got a bottle of pills, and I swallowed them, all of them, and went to sleep hoping not to wake up. But I did wake up the next day, and I had a terrible stomach ache, and I remember at that time thinking that I would push down every single sinful thought that I had about other boys, and I would try to act the way I was supposed to. Brené Brown and other researchers say that middle school is the time when kids really begin to push down and suppress different parts of who they are, and that was certainly the case for me. You should also know that 41% of transgender people have attempted suicide, 41%. And for me, there were these messages all over the place. It was from the church, it was from my mother, my teachers, the other students, all of these forces working together to tell me that who I was authentically was a problem. And at one point, I did not want to live. There's several moments in my life, actually, that I have not wanted to live. I'll skip ahead a little, but I remember, it was probably like 12 years ago. I was having a really rough time in New York, and I've written about this, and I remember thinking that I wanted to end it again, and this is as an adult. And I remember thinking that if I would, suicide thoughts, how uplifting. I was thinking I would jump off the Empire State Building because I lived in New York, and I made sure that I would have a note in my pocket that would say, my name is Laverne, and I should be referred to with feminine pronouns, and the name I was born with should not be referred to, because it was so important for me that when I died, that I wouldn't be misgendered in my death, which happens so much to trans people. But I'm really happy that I didn't do that, and I'm happy to be standing here before you today. So happy to be a survivor. So junior high was the time I started burying parts of myself, and I really became what Alice Miller calls in the drama of the gifted child, which is, if you don't know that book, you should check it out. It's major. And in the drama of the gifted child, Alice Miller describes the gifted child as a child who basically divorces parts of herself, or parts of her authentic self, and begins to define herself not by who she is or what she feels, but by what she does, by what she can achieve. And that certainly became the case for me. I became a straight-A student in junior high. I was a member of the National Junior Honor Society. I was public speaking champion in eighth grade, countywide. I'm still really proud of that one. And I became vice president of the student council, which is still sort of baffling to me, because a lot of the kids, of course, didn't like me. I was the kid who was bullied, who was chased home from school every day, yet they voted for me for student council vice president. But the year that I won, we got to make speeches, and right after our speeches, the kids voted. And I remember the first line of my speech was, "Quality is my principle, and qualified is my attitude." It was seventh grade, what can I say? And the kids were like, wow. And they voted for me. And to this day, I'm like, wow. So junior high was the period of achievement for me in my life. And I found out about this school in Birmingham, Alabama, which is 4 hours north of where of Mobile, my hometown. And the school is called the Alabama School of Fine Arts. And the second I found out about it, I knew I wanted to attend as a dance major, because I wanted to be a professional dancer and then transition to acting. That was always the plan. And there was this show in the 80s called Fame. Has anyone heard of this show? Second I found out about Fame, I was like, I have to go to an art school like that, and I have to dance on the tables in the cafeteria. And so I decided I wanted to go to the Alabama School of Fine Arts, and I wanted to be a dance major, but the dance program at ASFA was a ballet-only program. And as you recall, my mother would not let me take ballet, and so I needed a scholarship, and so I wasn't prepared to go and audition in the dance department and get a scholarship. So I had been writing at the time, and I decided I would submit myself in the creative writing department, start taking ballet, and change my major to dance, and that's exactly what I did. So I went to the Alabama School of Fine Arts. My brother went as well. He was an visual artist at the time. He was brilliant. He still is, although he's a musician now. And we got to the Alabama School of Fine Arts, and my brother and I were 2 of 3 black kids in the dorms, and we were there on scholarship, and it was really the first time in my life. Most of my life I had felt a tremendous amount of shame about my gender, and most of my growing up until that time was about gender. But when I got to ASFA, it was the first time I was starting to feel shame about being working class and about being black as well. Being around all of these privileged kids, it definitely made me feel like I was less than. We never had any money, you know, and everybody else was spending money on this and that, and it was deep. And also, what was fascinating to me too is that even though I was a straight-A student in junior high, when I got to ASFA, I realized that the education I had had up until that point really did not prepare me to compete with the other students. They had read things I hadn't read. They had been exposed to things I hadn't been exposed to. And so I had to play. I felt like I was playing catch up. And what really, again, made me feel like I was less than. It fed this shame thing. But what I did is I hustled for worthiness, is how Brene Brown would call it. I hustled for worthiness. So I would get out of school every day at 4 o'clock, and I would go to the cafeteria with all my books, and I would study from 4 to 10 p.m., which was curfew. And I would go to my room and study some more, and then I would do it all again the next day. I had no life, basically. I just studied. And I did okay. Although I always made B's in math and science. I could never get an A, except the one semester I got an A in physics and an A in algebra 2. I took driver's ed and got a C. And I think that the driver's ed teacher is still shaking after my on-road test. And to this day, I still don't drive, which is, there may be some trauma there, who knows. Anyway, so I eventually, you know, became a dance major at the Alabama School of Fine Arts and graduated as a dance major, went to Indiana University, and finally moved to New York City, which was always the goal. Yes, New York City. Any New York City in the house? Cool. We're in upstate New York. I forget where I am these days. I'm traveling so much. And when I got to New York City, I continued to be a good student, but my real education happened in the club scene of New York City. Yes. Yes, I said it. Now, a little bit about me at the time. By the time I got to New York City in high school, I'd started experimenting with the way I dressed. I started wearing makeup, and I started wearing women's clothes that I got from the Salvation Army and Goodwill. Never dresses, because I didn't want to end up in New Orleans wearing a dress. But I was a really big fan of culottes, and I remember I had this pair of black velvet culottes. And the great thing about culottes is that basically they were shorts, but they kind of looked like a skirt, so I could say, oh, they're shorts, they're not a skirt. And I just wanted to feel pretty. And I was also a big fan of big, wide-legged bell-bottoms. And I had this pair of black and white checkered bell-bottoms that I got from the Salvation Army, and this pair of leopard print bell-bottoms that were polyester and shiny and just fabulous. I would call it my Salvation Army couture, my Salvation Armani, if you will. And so I got to New York City, and I arrived at the club scene at that time, and my Salvation Army couture was celebrated in the club scene of New York City at the time. Now, it was the early 90s, and it was the age of the club kid. Has anyone seen that film Party Monster? It's a terrible film. But it sort of gives you an idea of what the club scene was like at the time. God, I'm going to say that it was a terrible film, and the filmmaker's going to be in the audience one day. I should stop saying that. But the club, it was the age of the club kid, and club kids were basically these folks who were, you know, dressed outrageously and got paid to go basically show up to parties and provide atmosphere and to party. And club kids were often very androgynous creatures, and they were gender nonconforming folks and drag queens, and I met the first transgender women in the club scene of New York City, and the folks that I would meet in the club scene of New York City would change my life. And there's specifically a woman by the name of Tina Sparkles. Yes. And I met Tina at a club called Webster Hall. Does anyone know Webster Hall? Webster Hall still exists. It's not really hot anymore. It was really hot back in the day. And there was a party called Makeup Room. And I remember I was powdering my nose at Makeup Room. And Tina had forgotten her powder that night. And so she asked to borrow mine. And we became friends. Not super close friends, but whenever I would go out, I would see her and we would talk. And Tina was about 6'5", 6'6", in heels. She was African-American. She had this big Diana Ross kind of hair. And she's wearing thigh-high boots. And she had, she could have had this very sort of pimply skin. But she was the sweetest queen that you would meet. And over the next several years of knowing Tina, I watched her transform from this statuesque queen to this beautiful, sophisticated woman. And watching Tina's transition, I said to myself, if Tina can do this, what can I do? And if it weren't for Tina Sparkles and all of the amazing women that I met in the club scene of New York City, I might not have ended up at Dr. Risch's office almost 16 years ago for my first hormone shot and the beginning of my medical transition. Now, I think it's just really important to note that I had all of these misconceptions about who transgender people were. I had all this, since I was in third grade, in my head, the whole idea of ending up in New Orleans wearing a dress, I associated that with being some sort of degenerate, with a person not being successful, being some sort of street person is really what was in my mind about who trans people were. And from what I'd seen in the media, I didn't associate being transgender with being accomplished and successful. And I was being groomed by my mother and my teachers to be an accomplished, successful person. And when I finally got to meet actual trans people, all of the misconceptions I had about that group of folks disappeared. And I got to know them as people. And I believe that can be the journey for everyone. If we get to know people, as human beings, all of the misconceptions that we might have about people who are different from us can fade away. I was able to accept them, and therefore, I was able to better accept myself. Amazing. So I'd imagine that my transition would go a little bit like Tina's. I figured like two, 3 years into my transition, I'd be able to walk down the street. No one would know that I was trans. I could just live my life healthy, happy, and free. And, you know, 3, 4, 5, 6 years into my transition, that wasn't happening. I was still getting spooked on the street. Now in New York City, we say spooked for, it's a colloquialism meaning that someone can read you as trans, can tell that you're trans. In other parts of the country, they say clocked, but since I'm from New York City, I'm saying spooked. So I would go walk down the street and I would be getting spooked. And now when I got spooked as trans, people would say, I think that's a transgender woman. That's not what they would say. Not at all. They would say, that's a man. Oh, that's a man. That's a man. That's what they would say. And they would say it so loudly that everyone within a 3-mile radius could hear them. And it felt like, always would feel like it was intended to humiliate me, to sort of call me out, and as if I was some sort of imposter when I was just walking down the street as myself. And I've come to believe that calling a transgender woman a man is an act of violence. And I say that because so often the subtext of that's a man, there was violence attached to it. Several months ago in New York City, I was walking down the street and I passed this guy, and he's with this sort of venom, he said, you'd like a man who can really fight, as if it was a challenge, let's fight. And several years ago, 6 years ago, I was walking down the street in Midtown Manhattan, and I passed this group of men, and I heard anti-gay slurs, I heard that's a man, and then one of them kicked me. So there's often violence attached in my experience to that misgendering of trans women. And you know, I have to say I feel very lucky, because so often being kicked on the street is really, and just being called out, while it's humiliating and awful, and it often has made me feel unsafe, at least I'm here. I'm here to tell the tale. On August 17th of last year, a beautiful young trans woman, 21 years old, African American, by the name of Ilan Nettles, was walking down the street with a friend of hers in New York City in Harlem. She was catcalled by a group of guys. One of them realized she was trans, and she was beaten into a coma. 5 days later, she died. Over 6 months later, there still has not been an arrest made. And so often, the disproportionate murders of transgender women, often transgender women of color, go unsolved. We need some justice for Ilan Nettles today. We need some love for Ilan Nettles today. There was a moment about 12 years ago in New York City. It was the 4th of July, and I remember I was wearing a red, white, and blue dress. It was very tight, and I was feeling very patriotic. And I lived on the Upper West Side at the time, and I was walking to the 72nd Street subway, and I passed these two guys, and one of the guys appeared to be Latino, and the other guy appeared to be black, and the Latin guy says, yo, ma, you looking sexy today. Can I holler at you, yo? Something like that. And then the black guy says, yo, dude, that's an N-word. And then the Latin guy says, no, man, she looked too good to be an N-word. That's a B-word. And they began to argue. That's an N-word, that's a B-word, that's an N-word, that's a B-word. And I'm just standing there at the corner, just like waiting for the light to change so I can get out of there. And I tell this story because it's so intriguing to me on a lot of different levels. First of all, it's fascinating that the B-word and the N-word were the options. These were the two options. That's still deep to me. But it points out to me the intersections of trans misogyny and issues of race that happen in the lives of so many transgender women walking down the street in this country today. Just walking down the street as a trans woman is often a contested act, right? So first of all, I was catcalled because I'm a woman, and they acknowledged me at my womanhood, but the calling me a B word in that context felt a little misogynist to me. It didn't feel like the most, you know, affirming moment. And then they realized I was trans, and so the N word happened. And I understand that in this context, that the N word not signified to mean that I was a black man. I doubt, although I can't read their minds, I doubt they would have used the N-word if I were white. So that we understand that the N-word changes because of context, that it can be re-signified in different contexts. So in this context, it seemed the N-word meant synonymous with being a black man. So we see the intersections of race and transphobia and misogyny in this moment. And I've been criticized, I should say, for telling the truth of my experience, that most of the harassment and bullying I've experienced throughout my life has been from other black people. I'm always careful to say that this is not to suggest that black folks are not coming from other folks, but it's just the truth of my experience. Literally, it's not a black man, 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 it's Thank you. Have a seat, have a seat. We're going to do a little Q&A. Oh, do you want to?
No. All right, mics are on. All right, so we have two volunteers. Okay. So if you want to ask a question, please raise your hand. Come on out to the aisle. Our volunteers will take out the mic so that I can have that. We have about 20 minutes here. Keep your questions.
Separate from being a twin, and it's, so it's important too to say to that my journey is not his journey. That even though two people can be in the same household, we can have very different experiences. But my brother is amazingly supportive. He lived in San Francisco for years, and he's very politically progressive. He calls himself politically radical, and when folks have asked me over the years, oh, is your brother gay, straight, what? He prefers the term practicing homosexual. He feels the word gay is a white bourgeois construct. Those are his words, not mine. So my brother has been nothing but supportive of me, and we have our familial stuff, but it's never, me being trans has never been an issue. It's always been, he has trans friends of his own that I don't even know, and he's just unbelievably accepting. So I'm very blessed, very lucky.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Hello.
Hello.
Hi, nice to meet you, I'm Jen.
Hi, Jen.
After hearing your speech, I feel like a lot of people would be empowered by you, and a lot of people treat you as a role model. So what do you think is the political leadership of African-American trans women in American society in terms of the bourgeois ideology that you just mentioned? And what is your definition of a sophisticated woman?
Work. But, well, first of all, I don't like the term role model. I prefer the term possibility model, because I would never be so arrogant as to think someone should model their life after me, but there have been major folks in my life who've shown me that certain things are possible, and so I'd love for folks to think some things that might be possible for them in their lives. In terms of sophistication, that's a really interesting question, and I like that you're asking me that, because it's challenging me. For me, Tina was sophisticated because of the way she carried herself, and she had this certain kind of elegance, and she had a certain kind of class, which is a really problematic term. But she was sophisticated in terms of her care. She had a certain kind of dignity about herself. She was a dignified black woman, and I guess I grew up with these very sort of, my mom is this dignified black woman, and my idol Leontine Price had she's an opera singer, a black opera singer. I idolized these very sort of dignified black women who had like a lot of pride, you know, and carried themselves well. And in terms of leadership, yes, a lot of stuff. In terms of the leadership question, challenging the bourgeoisie, I think it's important to have difficult conversations and to speak truth to power. And I think that everybody from wherever location they are, it's important for all of us to challenge how we're privileged and to be very critical of our own location. Cornel West talks about, so he says when his new students come into his class, his philosophy classes, he says, be prepared to learn how to die. And what he means is being prepared to come into a new critical consciousness, to leave behind what we thought we knew, to come to a new critical understanding. And so that's something that I'm constantly trying to do. And I think that's something that we all should be working towards, having what we think we know, being able to let that go to come to new critical consciousness. And I think that's how we can be better leaders and better allies. All righty. Hello.
Hi. My name is Sylvia.
Hi, Sylvia.
I have this sort of dilemma between feminism and passing, because if passing is an attempt to sort of, you know, blend into society, as some people might say, then aren't we just becoming, like, subordinate to the expectations of society of what a woman should look like? So I just want to
know. Well, I'm loving these questions. Work. First of all, Janet Mock, my dear friend Janet Mock. You know Janet Mock, right? You should all get her new book, Redefining Realness. It's everything. But Janet Mock, I love the way she talks about the concept of passing. She's like, I'm a woman. I'm walking down the street as a woman. I'm not passing as anything. I'm just being myself. I'm living visibly as myself. So for me, historically, the whole concept of the need to pass often exists in a cultural context where being who you are. When historically, when we look at Black folks who passed for white, it was necessary for a lot of Black folks at the time to have some kind of, to be able to get a certain kind of education and to be able to have any kind of upward mobility, some of them had to pass. And so that wasn't a critique of the system, that wasn't dismantling the system of oppression, but it was sort of playing into it. I think it's important for each and every one of us to define what it means to be a man or a woman on our own terms. And I think for me, the idea, I feel like I've let go of the idea of passing. I understand that for me, sometimes people will look at me and see that I'm trans. And I've come to believe that that is okay, and that in fact that's beautiful. And that being trans is beautiful. And the reality is that women come in a different shapes and sizes. We have our voices are lower or higher. I mean, women have all different kinds of experiences. And it's important to acknowledge and honor all of those experiences. So.
Hi, I'm Lauren.
Hey.
You're a wonderfully talented and accomplished actress. And
thank you.
You really are. And I think you're very, very accomplished about all your accomplishments in transgender roles, but I wonder, when you go to audition, do you audition as a woman or as a transgender woman, and how does your identity impact your acting and how you approach new roles?
I always, you know, I love acting because I love the opportunity to sort of channel other people and to play different characters. I often can say things I feel like in character that I maybe can't say as myself. I go to auditions as myself with my own history, and I'm a woman, but I'm also a trans woman. It's auditioning for roles that weren't really. I work in an industry that years ago I was in a casting session with a casting director. It was just sort of a workshop with a casting director from a very prominent network, one of the top four networks. And I asked him after we had done some scene work, and he complimented my work, and I asked him, would you ever submit a trans actor for a role that didn't call for someone trans? And he said no. He said no because the producers and directors would be able to tell, and it would be a distraction. I think basically he felt like he would lose credibility by submitting a trans actor. So I think the piece of me as a trans actress playing roles that are not specifically written as trans was really going to be about the directors, writers, and producers having the vision to do that. And I believe that's going to happen. I believe we're going to get there. And part of the reason that Leontine Price is my idol is that Leontine Price was the first sort of internationally renowned opera singer. There have been a few before her, but she, like, Marian Anderson sort of opened the door, and she and Leontine Price sort of blew it off the hinges, you know. In her Metropolitan Opera debut, she got a standing ovation for like over an hour. They stood up just screaming for her because she was so good. And I've always my whole life believed that if my work is really, really good, it can transcend labels. So I work to be really, really good at what I do so that I can transcend labels. So I believe I've come to believe that anything is possible. I mean, I'm a black trans woman from Mobile, Alabama, giving a keynote here tonight. That's like, it's kind of crazy. So anything is possible.
Hi, I'm Brandon.
Hi, Brandon.
Nice to meet you. You really helped validate, I'm transgender, you really helped validate my identity and my family, just, you know, watching your speeches. And I was wondering why you first started speaking out and what your goal is when you speak out to people.
That's a good question. I've always sort of been political around my identity. Growing up in Alabama, my mom was political. And, about 6 years ago after I did that, you all laughed when you heard I was on a reality show called I Wanna Work for Diddy. I laugh when I think about it too. But when I did that show, all of a sudden I had a national platform that I didn't have before. And I remember having a conversation with my brother, and I was like, well, I'm political, and a lot of people don't understand trans people, and is it okay for me to be on mainstream television and be as political as I really am? And he said to me, if you're going to have a public platform, you should use it for good and for what you believe in. And just being famous to be famous is a little shallow and ridiculous. And so a lot of it's been about me being authentically who I am and just speaking the truth as I see it publicly. But then also, a lot of trans women of color don't have the platform that I have, and their voices are often silenced. And so it's been really important for me to amplify those voices I've always jokingly said I'm here to educate as well as entertain. So that's what I do. And I think that I have a lot of messages. I think one of them is about creating spaces of gender self-determination for everyone, particularly our children. And I also think it's important for each and every one of us to define what it means to be a man or a woman on our own terms. I think whether we identify as trans or gender nonconforming or not, that most of us are constrained by the logic of the gender binary model. I've dated so many straight identified men who would never want someone to know that they were dating me because their masculinity would be called into question. They're allowing themselves to be defined by these ideas that other folks are putting onto them. I think having spaces of being really truly free and having spaces of gender freedom is something we should all be striving for. Who's next? Hi.
My little sister just came out publicly as trans last month.
I'm sorry, say that again?
My little sister just came out publicly as trans last month.
Uh-huh.
And she couldn't make it here today. She's in Philadelphia. But she wanted me to tell you thank you, because for her, you still are one of her major disability models, and she wouldn't have found the courage to come out and transition if it wasn't for you. And she's sorry she couldn't be here today. Mm.
I'm sorry, how old is she?
19.
She's 19. You know, gosh, you know, the funny, I didn't come out to my mom till I was out of her home. And for me, it was, I so often when kids come out as trans or LGBTQ, they might be turned out of their homes. We see that happening. The homeless population among kids is really, a lot of, I think 41% are LGBT. So I think it's important to like know your parents and to know that hopefully if you're still living with them that they'll be loving and supporting and kind of gauge whether so that you're not put out into the street, because I think it's really important. And I would also say that I think the biggest thing, every parent's different, but I think most of our parents, if they really love us, they just want us to be happy and healthy. And so coming out to them and saying that this is about me being more authentically myself and really me being really happy. And you know, for me, it was also really important to assure my mother that I was going to the doctor and getting blood work done, and that all the medical stuff was done in a healthy way, because my mom was really concerned about that stuff too. It's really complicated. Every situation is different. So I think too, for kids younger than 19, I think it's important to figure out how to stay in school and get an education too, especially for kids of color. Because so often, it's, as I've stated before, it's not safe for kids in school. So I think it's important if we are coming out or expressing our gender that we're able to do it in spaces where we're able to get an education. Because if you're poor and a person of color and you're trans and like you don't have an education, then it's like,
It's rough. So, has she told her parents yet?
And her mom has accepted it. She's still working on not misgendering her, but she's still been trying to figure out the best way to tell her dad. So,
okay. Yeah, I think it's about taking time to. I think it's about her doing it on her own time as well, so that she is able to feel comfortable and able to go to her dad with the confidence that she needs in who she is. So I think it's about her feeling comfortable too, so it doesn't really matter what they say, that she's going to be who she is no matter what.
Thank you all.
So.
We are on a schedule. I think we can maybe take one or two at most. So I am really sorry. I hate to be that guy, but I want to put that out there. All right, Sabrina.
I give long answers too, sorry.
Okay.
Hello, ma'am. Good evening. I'm Chad.
Hi, Chad.
I was one of the Southerners that called out a little earlier this evening. I'm from Atlanta, Georgia, originally, and I live up here now. My question is, your talk about your friend Jeremiah really convicted me to want to come up and ask some advice from you. So my best friend in the whole world, we went to college together, we stayed in contact during grad school. I'm a queer-identified male, cisgendered, and I recently got engaged to my partner of 4.5 years.
Congratulations.
Thank you. And our wedding is planned for next summer, and he can't be here this evening, but I disclosed before I became engaged to my partner, to my best friend, who's an African-American cisgendered female, and we met in the church. And I left the church because of being queer-identified. I'm still Christian and very spiritual, but I knew that wasn't the right spiritual home for me. And so she's been very supportive over these years, but we've had very intense dialogues. I love that you talk about love and empathy to cross and make bridges across those gaps. But recently, when I disclosed that information to her,
you disclosed that you were getting married.
That I'm getting married. Mm-hmm. Yeah. She told me that she didn't have any words to say and that she loves me, but she can't support my getting married. Mm. And so this was, on some level, I think it wasn't really very. I wasn't surprised. Mm-hmm. But on another level, it hurt immensely. She was the only person I told before I did it. So my question for you is, I know you grew up in the church yourself and were very involved with spiritual life. So what advice do you have for people who are spiritual identified or have friends and family who are spiritual identified and working through being queer and spiritual and bridging those gaps?
Mm. That's a great question. What I would say, I mean, I grew up in the church, but now I still believe in God. I still pray. I could pray before I came out here today. I prayed several times today. I don't really, organized religion doesn't work for me personally now, but I respect folks who need that. What I would say, coming from a religious tradition, is that it is God's place to judge people, not our place to judge people. Our job is to love our neighbor as ourselves, you know, it's literally scripture, and that is our job, I'm sad that your friend has not been supportive of you, but I also think sometimes we have to let some people go in our lives, and it's deeply painful when we love someone that we have to let them go, and maybe you'll be able to work through this, maybe she'll sometimes when we really love someone, we may need to take a break from them, and they need to miss us and realize how important we are in their lives, and maybe that'll happen, or maybe it won't. But I think that if someone says that they can't support who you are authentically because of God, then that doesn't sound very godly to me. I don't know exactly what to say to that. I'm sorry, but I think God is about love, and I believe intensely that God made me the way that I am, and that I am called by God to do the work that I'm doing. This is because of God. So, thank you. Good luck, and congratulations. And the last question.
I think we have one quick question.
Thank you so much for coming, and I'm actually writing my thesis on performing religious identity, so I'm really
Oh, thank you. Very generous.
Hi. Hello. I'm Kylie.
Hi, Kylie.
So I'm really interested and intrigued by the idea of representation or lack thereof for certain groups in television.
Yes.
And there was a quote, I don't know it verbatim, that Jenji Cohen said something in regards to Orange is the New Black and how in order to tell these stories authentically about women of color, trans women, gay women, she had to sort of, in order to market it and get it on the screens, she had to create a character that was white and cisgender to kind of lead us into that world.
Jinji talked about Piper, the Piper Chapman character as a gateway drug to
yes,
all of these
exactly.
Stories of women of color, yes.
Yeah, so it intrigues me. I wanted to hear your thoughts on it because, you know, I guess television is supposed to reflect the viewer, and I just don't buy that it's, you know, straight, white, cisgendered viewers out there, and that's the only people watching television. So just from an inside perspective, why do you think it is that we need that straight, white, cisgendered character to sort of lead us into these other storylines?
Good question. Great question. And it's a complicated answer. First of all, I think a lot of it has to do with advertisers. I mean, with Netflix, we don't deal with advertisers, we deal with subscribers. But I've as a producer, I've pitched a lot of shows about trans women. I'm gonna say it. We've gone to networks and there's too many people of color. Can we have a white girl? No, I've heard that from networks. It's the truth. So can we have a white girl? And relatable becomes the word, you know, the word that the networks will use, and relatable tends to mean someone white and sort of is with a certain kind of educational background or whatever, someone who is white adjacent, if you will. Because one girl we cast, she was a woman of color. Like, okay, she's white enough. Like she was biracial and all this stuff. So that's part of it's advertisers, and I think like a lot of networks don't want to necessarily create a black show because they don't want to just be in that black market or a person of color show. So a lot of it's about advertisers, and then I think. Well, what I think is genius about Orange is the New Black, I mean, I don't know if I'd be here today without that show, is that what the response to that show, this show that with all this diverse, beautiful women of different shapes, sizes, ages, races, sexual orientations, gender identities, is that the audience is like, we're like a bona fide hit. And the demographic of folks who watch our show is everybody. Fans of Orange is the New Black come up to me who are Middle Eastern, who are Latino, black, white, multi-generations watching the show. People, you know, in their 60s and 70s are watching it. Kids, I don't know if there should be, who are, you know, 12, 13, 14 are watching the show. So it's crossed all of these different lines because people can see themselves. People can see themselves, and it's always been my hope with this show that we would show the industry that you can do a show with diverse people, and folks will watch, and that it's okay, that the world will not end if you have diverse people on television. So, in fact, spaces will open up where people feel that their voices are heard and that their identities and their lives matter. And I think that is what our representation should be doing, reflecting the lives and the humanity of everyone. Thank you so much, everybody. I'm so happy to be here. Great questions. Thank you.
All right, thank you so much for coming. And conference folks, we're not going to go out that door because there might be ice. So we're going to use the tunnel. And Kevin and Melinda and Kevin and Ryan are going to lead. If there's ushers, please remember to quickly stay back and clean up well. And otherwise, thank you so much for coming. Really appreciate it. And one more round of applause for Laverne Cox.